The Lord is good. Amen. He's assured of His love and my prayer is that each one of us not only feel that love but really experience that love. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. God is great. God is good. Amen. Praise God. Can we lower a little bit that slide at the front? I mean, just the one on the center. Lower it a little bit. Thank you. That's it. The Lord is good. And He always affirmed that on His daily graces and mercies upon us. Amen. Many of us and all of us could testify that God is good. And every day, He has demonstrated His goodness. Amen. Praise God. Let's pray as we bring the message of the Lord this morning. Father, thank you for your anointing. Thank you for anointed word. Thank you that today the Holy Spirit is here to minister to us. We ask for your illumination, for your spirit to bring into us the conviction. As we hear your word, we would receive it gladly. And thank you for your faithfulness. We give you back the praise, the glory, and the honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's try if this will work. Okay, here we go. It's not very much clear? It's okay? Okay. We bring to you a message this morning entitled Growing from Grace to Grace in Our Journey to Maturity. And it's found in, our text is in 2 Peter 1, 5 to 17. Okay. Shall we all read this together? I would ask you to please read it with me. Verse 5, now this very reason also, applying all diligence in your faith, supply moral excellence, and in your moral excellence, knowledge, and in your knowledge, self-control, and in your self-control, perseverance, and in your perseverance, godliness, and in your godliness, brotherly kindness, and in your brotherly kindness, love. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they will render you neither useless nor unfruitful in the true knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these qualities is blind, short-sighted, having forgotten his purification from his former sins. Next. Therefore, believers, be all the more diligent to make certain about his calling and choosing you, for as long as you practice these things, you will never stumble. And the last verse, for in this way, the entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ will abundantly supplied to you. Amen. Do you believe that? Amen. 2 weeks ago, I met a guy and because he requested for a ride, and I was the nearest one in the vicinity to respond to that request. He came out from a casino. Okay, and a little bit drunk. So on our way to his destination, I initiated a normal conversation by asking him, how was your day? And so he responded with honesty, it was all right. But the next phrase of that answer says, until I came into that place, referring to the casino. And so we exchanged conversation and asked me, do you do this transporting full time? I said, no. This is a part time. So he asked me, what's your full time work? I said, I'm working in a religious organization, church base. And the name of the church is Holy Ground Family Fellowship. And so he was surprised too. And said, yes, I'm one of the pastors. To my surprise, he shared to me his life. And so he said, you know what? I'm also a member of a church organization. I am one of the worship leaders. I just keep silent, you know. I just let him talk about that, you know. You know, he has some problems, and he said, you know what? I still understand that the Lord loves me. I said, yes. The Lord loves you. No matter who you are, the Lord loves you. I told him that. And so anyway, you know, this brings me to the sermon today. You know, my point for this morning's sermon, because a lot of people has a misconception on being Christian. Their concept usually extends their personal view of their own Christianity. They separated the sacred from the secular. And one of the book that I read, you know, pertaining this type, you know, of area, you know, in their Christian life, this particular commentator calls these people as religious schizophrenics. Okay. Hey, let's go back. Okay, there you go. Religious schizophrenics. I know that many of you knows what is schizophrenic, right? So anyway, so let me just describe what is this. Religious schizophrenic is hard to find. Hard to find in the sense that it cannot be identified by church attendance. Because although most of them are not really going to church, but there are a lot of them who are in the church, attending every Sunday, attending Bible studies. So it cannot be identified by the church attendance. It cannot be identified by their knowledge of the Bible. Although most of the religious schizophrenics are people who don't read the Bible. But there are some of them who read the Bible. They can quote verse by verse. But yet they are religious schizophrenic. The third one is it cannot be identified by their ministry involvement because they also involved in the ministry. So it's hard to identify. Now try to look at. Can we do that? Oh my. Next slide, please. Okay. In the Webster definition, it says, you know, this is just, you know, a phrase of what the Webster dictionary says. Schizophrenic is to have mutually contradictory or antagonistic parts or qualities. So, I mentioned a while ago about these people separating the secular to a sacred. Sunday, sacred day. Monday to Saturday, secular. Okay? 10% secret, 90% secular. What else? Religious activities, secret. Business activities, secular. Separate, secular, secret. So, it seems like it fits to the mutually contradictory or antagonist parts of qualities. Now, let me go to the next slide. So how then you identify a religious schizophrenics? So this is how we can define it. The person who claims to be a true Christian and yet their life is not controlled by the Holy Spirit. You can be a Christian, but your life is not controlled by the Holy Spirit. Another one is they claim to be Christians, but their actions are in what? Complete contradiction to that claim and antagonistic to the gospel. So what we're saying is this, okay, when you say I'm honest, because the word of God says I'm honest, but if you deal with IRS,
Can I get this one so that I could have some? And you know, no, just an example. No, not just that. You know, but many things. You know, many things. You know, you have the knowledge. You know the truth. You know what you're reading, but it's hard to put it into action, to apply it. So, religious skepticism, as he said, it is a person who claims to be a true Christian, and yet their life is not controlled by the Holy Spirit. They profess Christ, but they live life consistently defeated by sin. They claim to be Christians, but their actions are in complete contradiction to that claim, with their lives being even antagonistic to the gospel. They give the impression of being a Christian, but eventually the truth will come out, and they abandon Christ. Now, many years ago, it happens to a very well-known evangelist. You know, was very known all over the world. But we didn't know that there was a secret life that he lived too. Later on, and then it, boom, was caught, renting a prostitute, let the prostitute dance before him. Nobody knows, because it's in a private place. But later on, somebody saw it. Bam. Nobody would realize that that was his life. Now, next slide. Being a Christian or being a disciple of Christ and being consistently defeated by sin is mutually contradictory. Do you believe that? It's completely contradictory. Now let me go to the Word of God. Galatians 5, 16, 17. Next slide. Galatians 5, verse 16 to 17. Verse 16 says, "But I say, walk habitually in the Holy Spirit, seek Him, and what? Be responsible." That word. "Be responsible to His guidance." Now, you could be a Christian, but you're not responsible to follow the guidance of the Word of God. Correct. "And then you will certainly not carry out the desires of the sinful nature." Hindi ko nakabasa. "Which responds impulsively without regard for God and His precepts." Wow. Okay. And then verse 17 says, "For," 17, next slide, "the flesh sets its desire against," what? "The Spirit." Okay. And then, "the Spirit against the flesh, for these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please." A little bit, Pastor Eric Tamambo touched concerning this verse. But I'm not going to touch more on that. Because, as what we said, being a disciple of Christ and being consistent, defeated by sin is mutually contradictory. And the Word of God admonished us that. The only way for us to be consistently victorious is what? To walk in the Spirit. Like what it says in verse 16. Because it's very clear. Let's go back to verse 16. Habitually in the Spirit. What? To seek Him and to be responsive. Okay. Not habitually seeking the Word of God, but what? Responsive to the Word of God. Amen. Amen. So, now, in our churches, please do not misunderstand me that I'm talking about our church, but all over America, you can see this. It is of greater concern are the average people sitting in church pews across America that are plagued by religious schizophrenia. Or a less severe nature, but nevertheless just as destructive. You will see couples coming faithfully to the church. But you don't know that their marriage is on the rock. And the reason why? Because neither one of them is fulfilling their biblical role in marriage.
men, whether adults or young people, who are addicted to pornography. And it is slowly but surely destroying their moral foundation. Men and women who are trying to find a solution to their problems, just like the guy that I encountered 2 weeks ago. You know, he goes, you know, drinking, and some would be taking drugs just to forget their problems. There are even Christian singles. Whether you are a boy or a girl, you know, who are involved in premarital sex. And when you see the survey, Christian single scene, the incidence of sexually transmitted diseases is not much lower than the rest of the society. That's sad. There are families that are wracked by strifes because brothers to brothers, sisters to sisters, children to parents are fighting. These are everyday life that we could see around that we do not know. But this is what we call religious schizophrenics. How many of you believe that every problem that we face in life are the result of sin? Do you believe that? It's a result of sin. It's either, you know, my sin, it's either your sin or somebody else's sin, but the problems that we face in life are the result of sin. In fact, you cannot name any problem that ultimately is not the result of sin. If we recognize that sin is the problem, then the only correct solution is the one that deals with sin. Amen. And the solution that deals with sin is the Lord Jesus Christ. He has conquered sin and offers forgiveness for past sin. He gives victory over the present sin and in the future eternal life free from sin. Amen. Past, present, and future, Jesus is the answer. Hallelujah. So why then do those who have supported, recognize Jesus as their answer still have so many problems? Why are Christians defeated by sin so often? Why do so many professing Christians seek the solution of their problems in secular sources and philosophy? Next slide. Let's look at the next slide. Let's go to 1 Peter. Okay? So we'll go from verse 1. To verse 4. And this is what the word says. I'll just read this to you. Verses 1 to 4 says, Simon Peter, a bond servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have received a faith of the same kind as ours by the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, seeing that his divine power has granted to us everything pertaining to life and godliness, through the true knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. And verse 4 says, for by this he has granted to us his precious and magnificent promises in order that by them you might become, what? Partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world by lust. The question is, why then do this, those who have supposedly recognized Jesus as their answer, still have so many problems? It's very obvious. In Peter's, before going into that direction, it's very obvious in 1 Peter chapter 1 that the Word of God has given us beforehand, okay, the antidote or the solution. Now, I want to look at verse 1 because verse 1 can be summarized this way. Okay. You see that Simon Peter is writing to those who have the same kind of faith in Jesus Christ that he had. So we can assume that these are the followers of Christ. This faith was received by them. This faith comes by the righteousness of Jesus Christ. This faith recognizes that Jesus Christ is both God and Savior. Now, when you go to verse 2, let's go to verse 2. Peter's desire is for the grace and the peace of God to grow in them. And this would happen through what? Their close, personal, experiential knowledge of God, the Father, and Jesus Christ. Now, why we emphasize that particular thing? Close, personal, experiential knowledge of God. Because the grace and the peace of God only comes when you pass a test. You will know personally of what the grace of God means to you, what the peace of God means to you when you follow what He says. When you overcome the trials every day. Amen? When you say to somebody who offers you something that is not according to the Word of God, verbally say, no, because I know what the Word of God says. Amen. The third one. Verse 3. The divine power needed for everything pertaining to life and godliness has already been given to those who have this faith. So what is this everything? Okay. This divine power is available through a close personal experience knowledge of the God who has called us by His own glory and honor, or glory and excellence. Now, this is going back to verse 1. Everything. So that means to say, you know, you can name from salvation to your assurance of eternal life, okay, from the solution of the problems to God's answering your very small need. Everything He supplied. Verse 4, what does Peter say? By God's glory and excellence, He has already given those who have this faith previous, a precious and magnificent promises, which range from salvation and assurance, heaven of His peace, supply for our needs in the present. This enable every believer to escape the sinful corruption of this world and live in righteousness. So, summarizing, God has given to every Christian. That's you and me. It is not the only one that originally hears the word of the book of Peter. But us in this generation, it's the same thing. Christ has given everything needed to live a Christian life in victory over sin. God has already done His part so that a Christian can live in victory over sin. Amen. And you see the next slide, please. Forget about the next slide. Okay. So, there you go. That's what God has done for us. He has already done His part so that a Christian can live in victory over sin. Now, the life of faith is active. It is not passive. Amen? You believe that? The life of faith is active, not passive. So when it's active, it's not passive, it is always associated with our daily experience in whatever situation we have to live out that faith so that that faith will grow. It is lived by stepping out in trust of God's promises that God will do what He wants in our lives. Have you heard the saying, let go and let God? You hear that? In some sense, that's a good one. But most of the time when it applies to our Christian growth, it does not work. You know why? Because if you say let go and let God, it's just like the philosophy of the Filipinos, bahala na. Kung ano mangyayari, Diyos na lang ang bahala sa tanan. It's okay. I just forget it, you know. I will not do anything. Bahala ng Diyos. So, what is that philosophy eliminates? It eliminates Christians' obedience to God's command.
it eliminates Christian obedience to God's command. So, Peter says, you know, build your faith stronger. And how would we build our faith stronger? Okay? The next verse is our text that we read in verse 5 to 7. These are the stepping stones to victory and growth. And so Peter, the next slide. Is that verse 5? Okay, good. Thank you. Peter says, he started this way. Now for this very reason also. So what is that very reason? This points us back to the previous verses which we have just discussed and are summarized in saying God has already done his part in granting to us everything we need to live the Christian life. Now for this very reason, because God has already given to us, God has provided everything for us to live victoriously, he said, okay, this is how, the next verse says, what we have to do, our part. And so what is our part? Applying what? All diligence. Or in other words, making every effort. Whatever effort to supply alongside our faith. The salvation that we get. This free gift of salvation that Jesus gave to us. We have to apply all diligence, you know, in making ourselves that the everyday experience we have will really bring us into growth, making every effort. Supply along our faith. So what we are going to supply, these are the stepping stones that I told you. Verse 5. Next slide. Okay. For this very reason, applying all diligence in your faith, supply what? Moral excellence. I go back to verse 5, I'm sorry. Verse 5. And in your moral excellence, knowledge. And in your knowledge, self-control. And in your self-control, perseverance. And in your perseverance, godliness. And in your godliness, brotherly kindness. And in your brotherly kindness, love. Stepping stones. There are stepping stones. They are not optional if you would look at the verse carefully. These stepping stones for victory are not optional. They are some or they are the things that we have to do. That means this is our part. If God has given his part already, this is the part of the believer. These are stepping stones we are commanded to make, for we have a part to play in living out the Christian life in victory. We have to uphold our end in trying as best we can. Now, go back to that word applying. Okay, can I see the next slide? I think it's on the next slide. More years ago. Okay. Stepping stones to grow in victory. Moral excellence, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, brotherly kindness, and love. Okay, this is stepping stones. Going to that verse, applying, you know, in the original word, it represents or mean to be bring in beside. So beside that faith that we have already established in the Lord Jesus Christ, we have to bring in beside with diligence, okay, with earnest effort, this moral excellence, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, brotherly kindness, and love. Okay, bring along with our faith. Okay, and supplying that faith, you know, with each of these stepping stones to grow for each qualities of having a Christ-like character. Amen. So the false sense here is to bring alongside your faith a determined effort to fully and completely supply, equip, provide that faith with the things he goes on to mention in those verses. What is it that we bring alongside? Okay, we'll go there. Its quality is something that is being worked on all the time, even while also working on the next characteristics. So first one is moral excellence. Next slide. What is moral excellence? Okay, moral excellence. This is how we can define when anything in nature fulfills its purpose, that is excellence. Okay, for example, a land that produces a good crop is excellent because it is fulfilling its purpose. When you plant a crop and it will not bear fruits, that's not excellent. But when it bears fruit, what? That's excellence because it's fulfilling its purpose. So a tool that works correctly is excellent because it is doing what it's supposed to do. Now, what is a Christian supposed to do? A Christian is supposed, what? To glorify God because he has God's nature within him. Amen. That's what verse 4 says. And so when he does this, he shows excellence because he is fulfilling his purpose in life. And what is his purpose? Moral excellence means fulfilling what you are supposed to do, and that is to glorify God by your life by becoming like Christ and following him. Second one, the knowledge. Now this pertains not intellectual knowledge, but practical knowledge of understanding and application that comes with experience. Okay, the commentator Lenski described this way. Knowledge is a wise demeanor with a ready perception of what is useful or harmful, of what is to be done and to be avoided. Let me repeat it. A wise demeanor with a ready perception of what is useful or harmful, or what is to be done and to be avoided. So what specific knowledge is being referred to? The specific knowledge of what God has revealed about himself in his written word and in the nature. When you go to Romans 1:20, this is what the word of God says. This Paul tells us that nature reveals God's eternal power and divine nature to the extent that all men are without what? Excuse in failing to acknowledge and worship him. Even when you go and look at the sunset, the sunrise, the mountains around you, they're speaking of God's nature of who God is. Amen? And that would lead you to follow him, to worship him, because that's how God great is, even through the nature. Not only Paul says that in Romans 1:20, but David also. See, David wrote in Psalms 19 that the word of God is perfect, sure, right, pure, clean, and true, so that its effect is to restore the soul, make wise the simple, rejoice the heart, enlightens the eyes, endures forever, and be righteous altogether. That's the word of God. Pure, amen. Right, pure, clean, true, so that it effects to restore the soul. See? No wonder that in that last verse, you know, in verse 11, if you would notice that in verse 11, because David declares that the scriptures to be more valuable than gold. Amen? The word of God is more valuable than gold and sweeter than honey. He understood their importance in both warning him and bringing him God's blessing. So the knowledge in the word of God, in applying it and discovering who God is through your experience, gives us growth, and that knowledge is what? Received only by your mutual relationship with him. Amen. Self-control. What is self-control? This is one of the fruits of the Spirit. It is an abstinence. Can we get the next slide, please? It is one of the fruits of the Spirit. It is an abstinence from the lust of the world. Now, that does not pertain to sexuality only. Okay? It pertains to everything, you know, that makes you desire more than the Word of God. It is an abstinence from the lust of the world. It controls all which includes reason, emotion, and will through the knowledge of the Word and the will of God. So, This is the person who can control their stomach and stay on their diet. And most of us, I don't know if we agree. Not only that, but this is the single person who lives in a sexually promiscuous society and remains a virgin until marriage. Thank you for that amen. How about our young people? Do you amen for that? This is the spouse that continues to love and respect in obedience to God's command, even when disappointed and hurts because of unmet expectations. Or this is the person who controls his anger and frustration and remains calm while in the middle of the traffic jam. Not much in Fresno, but if you go to LA, if you go to San Francisco, you will always say, "Praise the Lord," every time. Perseverance. The word here, in the original word, says hupumon. Next slide. Hupumon. It's not Pokemon. Okay? Just want to be clear with that. Perseverance, from the original word hupumon, means what? To abide and dwell under. Okay? Dwell under means there is a situation, okay, who is very tight already, but you, what? Dwell under. Be patient. Persevere. Do not react. Okay. Now, perseverance deals with trials caused by things. Okay? Your situation and circumstances. It is not caused by a person. Okay? Things. I can't understand why, you know, Walmart or Best Buy would not open 8 o'clock in the morning. Because I'm in a hurry. Situation. You cannot control those situations. So, when we say perseverance, you know, you persevere. It's just like also in James 2, in James 1 chapter 2, it tells us that what we are supposed to do is to count it all joy. Okay, in those situations, count it all joy. My brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces what? Endurance. And the word endurance is similar to the word perseverance. We have to persevere in the trials living in the sinful, fallen world because things do not work the way God originally created them. We battle with things that break down and do not function properly, including our own bodies. We get sick. We get frustrated, but we persevere because the Word of God advises us so. Romans 8:9-10 tells that the world itself longs along with us for redemption. But until that happens, we have to persevere. Amen? Godliness. The biblical commentator Peter Lanes said this about godliness. Okay, next slide. It is the disposition in which the consideration of God controls the whole life. The consideration controls the whole life. In which he is held in supreme, what? Honor. Whereby his approval is so. It's not the approval of the philosophical, whatever you know about it. There's philosophy in the world. But he is held in supreme honor whereby his approval is so. And the doing of which constitutes its own happiness. You are contented. Whatever the word of God says, you are contented. Amen. And some Christians, you know, if the word of God says does not taste good for them, they'll go on what? Worldly philosophy. That's why they go to Manang Auring. Just like what Rian Fuentes said. You know, he consulted the medium, you know, of his future. No. We have to be content with what the Word of God says. Now, godliness is completely for God to be joyful about it. Now, some of our Christians and even our nominal Christians, friends, might call us fanatics when we stay what the Word of God says, and they call us, you're a fool. I remember in the early days, when you become a Pentecostal, they'll say you're a fool. Why? Because Pentecostal climbs the walls. They cry, you know, with their nose, you know, gabi tayang sipon. They call us fool. But don't you know that, you know, all of us is a fool for someone? Is a fool for something, right? And so one time this pastor was called, you're a fool. And the pastor said, yes, I am. I guess I am. I am a fool for Christ. Amen? I better be called a fool for Christ than a fool in this world. Amen? Because I wanted to live a life of godliness. Next one, the brotherly kindness. This is a word, Philadelphia, speaks of the love that exists in the friendship between two brothers. Brotherly love exists because of a likeness to the other. And Hebrews 13:1 admonishes us that let's love your or our fellow believers continually. Amen. Continually. I have 10 minutes. Okay, thank you. Let's love continually. Why? Because we have a common denominator. What is that? It's not because I don't like your face. We love because we are brothers and sisters in the Lord. Amen. Even though you like, don't like the smell of the one beside you, you still have to love the person. Because the Word of God says so. Amen. The last one is love. Agape love. This is agape love. Next slide. Love that exists and is given in spite of the differences. Wow. The self-sacrificing love that chooses and commits itself to the best interest of the other. This is hard. Because what you are going to do is to consider the other person. It is not yours. It is not your selfish desire. It is not your selfish wants. It is also the like of the other. Amen. Ito palagi to sa mga magtaayon. Couples. You argue because of one thing. You know, you don't like this. Your wife doesn't like this. And you don't like, you know, what your wife likes. And so you have arguments, you know. Where is agape love? Agape love says, it chooses and commits itself to the best interest of the other. Now, so all of this, how many? Seven? Right? Seven. Okay. Godliness, I start from the back. Okay, love, brotherly kindness, the godliness, perseverance. What else? Okay, self-control, knowledge, and then? Moral excellence. These are the stepping stones. These are the ones that Peter said, you have to add this. Okay. How are these qualities interrelated? The idea in this passage is that each of these qualities is added by faith to the previous qualities so that they build upon each other so that the whole or the entirety is strengthened. Without all this foundation, not developing them, you will still become religious schizophrenic. Because it's not growing in our lives. So what's the problem? It's our part. Amen. Do you admit that? I will admit. Because there's time that I am also a religious schizophrenic. What I believe, I can do it. All of us. But God admonishes us. Because to develop this is developing it by faith. How is faith defined in Hebrews 11:1? It defines this way. Faith is the assurance of things, what? Hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. It's on the other slide, please, Julian. Hebrews 11. Okay. The assurance of things hoped for the conviction of things not seen. Okay. Now, what he's saying is that faith is not a leap in the dark, but a reasoned conclusion to step forward into the unknown based on who is giving the direction. You know, to give you an example, you know, one of the adventures we have in Yosemite to go up in the Yosemite Dome. We have with us several new hikers, and these are all young people. And we had Eric. Is Eric Chu here? No, he's not here. Okay. Anyway, we have Eric Chu as our leader. So Eric Chu giving the hikers instruction what to do so that we will be able to reach the place and return safe. So Eric's assignment was to lead us all through the trail, passing through ravines, okay, narrow wooden bridges, rocky trails, climbing steep areas with ropes. And Eric Chu has experience. He has the ability and safety conscious. He has record of leading others in trail hiking and brought them back in safety. In other words, Eric has the character. Okay? He has the character. And so, because we could trust his character, we had faith that he would take us to the place and we are supposed to be, and that he would do so in a safe manner. So we did not fear walking, you know, into the challenging trails. We did not fear that we would get lost in the or be in danger, because we believe he would fulfill his responsibility toward us because we trusted him. But you know, take note that Eric Chu did not carry us into his arms to bring us to the place. What we did is to follow behind him, to take his cue, not to be on the other trail, just follow closely to him, obeying what he was instructing to us. We follow him. If one hiker did not follow the instruction, if one hiker went to the other trail, he would probably end up in danger or be in an accident or be in trouble. You know? The point is this. It's the same way when we trust God. It's the same way when we have faith in God. We believe God will keep all his promises toward us because we can trust his ability and character to fulfill them. Amen. Faith is the first step in this process and the means by which every other character trait, the seven one, that is added. And because I believe God is able to trust his character to do his part, then I can walk in faith where he leads me. I can believe what he says and trust. It is the best for me so that I step forward in faith in obedience to his directions. Each of these characteristics is pursued by faith, but they build upon one another to strengthen each other. Amen. So what are we going to supply in our faith? Again, moral excellence. We move forward to do what he wants us to do in glorifying him. And as we do, we gain our excellent experiential knowledge of God, which in turn strengthen our trust of him and striving to glorify him. And so this will lead us to self-control, because moral excellence is the opposite of selfishness. And self-control in turn strengthens moral excellence and walking in the knowledge of God. So these are added: perseverance, which arises from faith, excellence, knowledge of God, and self-control, and in turn strengthens each of them as they are applied to the hardship that are part of living in this imperfect world. All this produces the character. Amen. Our part to do. Faith, yes, thank the Lord, because he has saved us. He has assurance, but along with that assurance and our possession as believers in Christ, if we want to grow in the Lord and to walk in victory, we have to put ourselves by faith, you know, in developing those steps to victory. Amen. Every day in our experience, we have to see to it that there is moral excellence developing in us. There is that knowledge of God through those personal experiences we encounter every day. There is that perseverance to go on and not quit or not surrender. Amen. We have to maintain brotherly kindness because we are one in the body of Christ. Amen. And most of all, we can overcome and overlook our mistakes and our imperfection because of that agape love in God. Amen. You know, God has done His part, but we have to be diligent to our part, which essentially boils down to a life lived in obedient trust. Amen. Live a life in obedient trust that God will fulfill His part. So by faith, develop your character to be marked by moral excellence, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, brotherly kindness, and love. And the last verse on that verse 9 says, for by doing these things, actively developing these virtues, you will never stumble in your spiritual growth and will live a life that leads others away from sin. Amen. Do you believe that? You know, as I am hearing, you know, I was studying this, I was hearing the word of God striking me. How about you, Gander? How is the word of God applied to you? I know your heart. You're obedient. I know your heart. You have a heart for the ministry. But how much do you allow me to mold you and to make you as I wanted you to be? I have to think, because this can only be answered through the daily experiences we have in life that will lead us to apply the Word of God so that we will be developed fully and will grow into maturity. Amen. May the Word of God brings enlightenment to us this morning, and we will continue to live for Him until the day when we see Him face to face. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you so much, oh God, for the time. Thank you for your people that listens to your word. I pray that the Holy Spirit, oh Lord God, will just bring water into your word. We'll not only hear this today, but it will keep ringing in our hearts. We'll be able to do what you desire us for to do, oh Lord. And our part is that to walk trusting in you. In our daily experience, we will see you personally, oh God, and we could apply your word in every situation that we have. We could see ourselves daily growing from grace to grace until we reach the end of our journey. Thank you so much, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.